pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. Things started, things starting to slip away. Everybody's having such a good time. Good to see everybody here today. Want to make a special welcome to folks joining us online, whether it be down at Wesley Chapel or Fellowship Hall or outside, wherever you might be joining. We're all joining together in one big opportunity to worship. I'm Pastor Bob. It's good to see everybody here. Let me give you a few announcements and then we'll turn to worship. Just a reminder, there's some information in the bulletin concerning this also. We're having a confirmation class coming up. I think we have 14 people signed up at this point. We're looking for having some more. The deadline for that is September the 7th. So email myself or Julie concerning that if you have any interest in a confirmation class. Also, downstairs, there's two sign-up sheets. We have a marriage night coming up September the 19th. You can register for that. And we also have three new Sunday school classes that we're going to be kicking off in the middle of September that you can sign up for also. So those are the announcements that we want to make. We're going to have a presentation of a scholarship. Cindy's going to lead us through that. So at this time, you come forward.
Good morning. Dr. Robert and Lorraine Beeman were former members of our church. Those who knew Lorraine understood she was a person of determination, conviction, and faith. When Lorraine was dealing with a serious health condition, she planned the creation of a scholarship which would allow her legacy to touch the future through the lives of others. In Lorraine's memory, Dr. Beeman endowed a scholarship to encourage young women from our congregation to enter post-secondary education. To apply for the scholarship, the applicant is asked to write a brief essay about Lorraine's life and faith walk. The applicant is also asked to share about how faith in God has influenced her life. When the scholarship committee reviewed the application submitted by this young woman, we were touched by the honesty and depth of faith it revealed. So on behalf of the scholarship committee, it is my pleasure to introduce and to present this award to Jocelyn Black. And Jocelyn's agreed to say a few words.
Hi, I'm Jocelyn Black, and I just graduated from Bedford High School. My plans are to attend the Fashion Institute of Technology in New York and major in advertising and marketing communications, and later receive my bachelor's degree in trade and marketing for the fashion industries. Due to COVID, I'm actually not going anywhere anytime soon. So next year is when I'm planning to go. But I just wanted to thank the church for choosing me and for helping me with my academic career. So thank you.
Thank you. As Jocelyn prepares for the next step in her life, I would like to ask everyone to support and to encourage Jocelyn and all of our youth with your ongoing love and prayer. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you for sharing that. We're going to have an opportunity to worship now as the worship team make their way forward. I invite you to stand and from a distance pass the peace of Christ to your neighbor.
Well, good morning out there. Whether you be out in the tents or over in Fellowship Hall or down with Wesley or out there online or here in the sanctuary, we'll all walk into worship here together. We're going to start with one called Raise a Hallelujah. And in the Hebrew Bible, hallelujah means a joyous praise and song to boast in God. Got a couple friends that are on vacation. I know you people online out there want to say hi to all of you, but one of our good buddies, and I see his wife's here, but he's home recovering from surgery, Bob Weiland. We told him we would all wave to Bob online. So,
you lost your light
He's watching right now. So hey, hello, Bob. Hello, Bob. We miss you. Looking forward to seeing you soon. All right, Jolie, not too fast on this one.
Right.
Be carried away. She always tells me I'm too fast. Sarcasm. 1, 2, 3, 4. About all the things going on in the world and keeping a right attitude. And remember Job 13, verse 15. Though you slay me, all my hope is in God, And I remember Franklin Graham, not to get too political, Ruth, but he was asked what political party he was putting his hope in. He said, well, not in the Republican Party and not in the Democratic Party. All my hope is in Jesus. And just coincidentally, that's the song Julie's going to start for us. Okay. I've been held by the Savior, and I felt far from above. I've been down to the river. I ain't the same, a prodigal return.
Thank you for sharing that. I'm going to turn now to a time of prayer. If you have a bulletin, we have a bunch of names in the bulletin. I want to lift up a couple. Tom Slocum's having some health issues this week. We need to be praying for him for sure. Just got that message not too long ago. Fred McKinley's also having some health issues that are being a little bit stubborn, so we can pray for him also, I believe, this week. We got a message. Carolyn Barnhart's having some procedure or a procedure this week. Monday. Okay. Pray for Carolyn. Procedure coming up this week for sure. The family of Keisha and Justin Smith in the loss of one of their fathers. I'm not sure which one, but let's keep that family in our prayer. Have at least two unspoken prayers also that God knows about that we can be praying for. Last week we prayed for our schools, in particular the administrators and the people, the workers there. This week, how about if we pray for the teachers and the students? I think it would be quite appropriate that we lift those folks up in prayer this week. So with those things and many others in our hearts and minds, let's be in an attitude of prayer, shall we? And let's talk to God this morning. Holy God, we are indeed blessed to be here in your house of worship. It is in such a blessing. Help us to never forget the people to make this possible for us, that we can join together and worship your Son, Christ. We have a list of people in our hearts and in our minds concerning prayers and health issues. We ask for you to be in all those situations, to bring your healing touch and your encouragement in all those situations. And Father God, we ask you to speak to us today. We know that you're here. We know that you're present with us. So open our hearts and minds this morning so we can hear from you, so we can be led and directed by you. We just are so blessed to be here. So speak to us. We'll conclude this prayer with the prayer that Jesus taught us all those years ago, as we have an opportunity to say this all together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen indeed. We're going to look at wrestling with each other today. We talk a little bit more about our mini sermon series on wrestling. It's going to be wrestling with each other today. And we got a scripture, a pretty familiar scripture. Definitely speaks to people wrestling with each other. It's from Jacob and Esau. It's Genesis 25, 19 through 34 is a scripture that we're going to be using. So let's look at God's word as we get ready to talk about wrestling with each other. Genesis 25, verses 19 through 34. This is the account of the family line of Abraham's son Isaac. Abraham became the father of Isaac, and Isaac was 40 years old when he married Rebekah, daughter of Bethuel the Aramean, and from Padan Aram, and sister of Laban the Aramean. I didn't do any better this time than I did at 9, the 8:30 service. But anyhow, Isaac prayed to the Lord and on behalf of his wife because she was childless. The Lord answered his prayer, and his wife Rebekah became pregnant. The babies jostled each other within her, and she said, "Why is this happening to me?" So she went to inquire of the Lord. The Lord said to her, "Two nations are in your womb, and two peoples from within you will be separated. One people will be stronger than the other, and the older will serve the younger." When the time came for her to give birth, there were twin boys in her womb. The first to come out was red, and his whole body was like a hairy garment, so they named him Esau. After this, his brother came out, with his hand grasping Esau's heel, so he was named Jacob. Isaac was 60 years old when Rebekah gave birth to them. The boys grew up, and Esau became a skillful hunter, a man of the open country, while Jacob was content to stay at home among the tents. Isaac, who had a taste for wild game, loved Esau, but Rebekah loved Jacob. Once, when Jacob was cooking some stew, Esau came in from the open country famished. He said to Jacob, "Quick, let me have some of that red stew. I'm famished." Jacob replied, "First, sell me your birthright." "Look, I'm about to die," Esau said. What good is the birthright to me? But Jacob said, swear to me first. So he swore an oath to him, selling his birthright to Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau some bread and some Lenten stew. He ate and drank and then got up and left. So Esau despised his birthright. And as we know, the wrestling was starting. We're going to talk about that a little bit. Let me give you an illustration to start out our sermon from this morning. It all started with a cotton swab. Dr. Mohan was the surgeon. Dr. Chan was assisting as the anesthesiologist, and the nurse stood vigilantly nearby. The patient, an elderly woman, was pleasantly snoring on the operating table. The date was October 24, 1991, and all was going as planned. An operation was scheduled and underway at the Medical Center of Central Massachusetts in Worcester, Massachusetts. Dutifully doing his job, Dr. Chan administered the anesthesia, sending the patient into a deep, sense-free slumber. And then with confidence that comes from more than two decades of experience, Dr. Mohan deftly began the procedure. All was going well. Except it seems for our two physicians. No one knows for sure what words passed between them, but the intent was clear. These men didn't like each other. Silently, the minutes ticked by, and with each passing moment, the tension in the operating room grew thicker and thicker. Whatever reason, at one point during the operation, Dr. Chan muttered a profanity in the surgeon's direction, and almost without thinking, Dr. Mohan flicked a cotton-tipped prep stick disdainfully at the anesthesiologist. Apparently, the surgeon was a good aim because the tiny cotton swab hit its target and sparked everything that was about to happen. Dr. Chan retaliated. First came some shoving, then an all-out brawl between the two men of medicine. Fists were flying, and the surgical goals were forgotten. The fight escalated into a wrestling, punching, jabbing, name-calling bout, rolling around on the operating floor. And the patient, how did she do in the middle of this? Well, she slept right through it. Finally, the two doctors grew a little bit tired. They regained their composure, actually got up and finished the operation. And not long after that, they were both fined $10,000 by the Board of Registration in Medicine in order to join in some psychotherapy for their aggressive tendencies. And to think that it all started with a simple cotton swab. Here's the part. It seems to me we look at this story and scriptures like we have the advantage of seeing in the Bible. It seems to me that we humans have a tendency to wrestle with each other. Part of our human condition is that we wrestle with each other from time to time. Sometimes it's about really important things, outwardly important things, things that may be cut to the very fabric of what we believe. And sometimes, if we're honest with ourselves, we wrestle about silly things, maybe things like cotton swabs. What's going on? Why do we tend to do that? What's happening that we sometimes allow that to happen? That's the first part. I want to kind of look at what's going on that we sometimes become wrestlers in the middle of our journeys of faith. And I want to look at James 4. We're going to look at some of James 4 to get some ideas of some of the reasons why we wrestle. This is just going to be a few words from James 4. You can check it out later on if you wish to. So let's see if we can get some godly hints about why we might be wrestling. James 4, we're going to start at verse 1. It says this, "What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? You desire but do not have, so you kill. You covet but you cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and fight." We wrestle, here's the first reason we can see from this scripture, we wrestle because we want stuff. We covet the stuff that somebody else has and we see and we want. That's one reason why we sometimes wrestle with each other. Move on and start at verse 4 now. It says this, "You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think Scripture says without reason that he jealously longs for the Spirit he has caused to dwell in us? We wrestle with each other from time to time because we become friends with things of the world." Things of the world. We see the things around us and we have them as our friend instead of having the love of God in our hearts and our souls. God wants us to jealously love him above all other things. Why? Because we start loving the things of the world, we start to wrestle with each other. It's a second reason I can see from this scripture. Let's move on. Verse 7 is where I'm at now. "Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Come near to God and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up." We wrestle with each other because we're sinful. We're arrogant. We're proud. And we don't humble ourselves enough before God. There's another reason why we sometimes find ourselves wrestling with each other. Let's move on. Starting at verse 11 now is where I'm at. "Brothers and sisters, do not slander one another. Anyone who speaks against a brother or sister or judges them speaks against the law and judges it. When you judge the law, you're not keeping it, but setting in judgment of it, on it. There is only one lawgiver and judge, the one who is able to save and destroy. But you, who are you to judge your neighbor?" We wrestle with each other from time to time because we think we had the responsibility to judge those other people in our lives, especially when we perceive what they're doing is wrong. And when we go that way, we feel that we have the freedom to slander them because of their actions. We don't have the right to be judging others. We don't have that right. Sometimes that leads us to wrestling matches. Let's move on to 13. "Now listen, you who say today or tomorrow we will go this way or that, or go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business and make money. Why, you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. And it is, you boast in your arrogant schemes. All such boasting is evil. If anyone then knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is sin for them." We wrestle with each other from time to time because we feel that we are the center of the universe and that we know God's plans. We know God's plans moving forward. And if the people aren't around us who aren't playing into those plans, then we argue with them. Those are just some of the reasons that I see coming from some James 4. There's many reasons that we wrestle for sure, but I think one thing that we can all agree on is we're going to be wrestling. That's a part of our reality. It's a part of our human condition. That's the first part of the sermon that I want to lift up. Wrestling. It's going to be happening in our lives for sure. Let's move on to the second part. This is the second part. Is all wrestling bad? Is all wrestling bad? I want to share what I believe. I don't think all wrestling is necessarily bad. There's definitely some bad things that can come out of our wrestling. That's for sure. No doubt about that. But I think God can use our wrestling to do good things, to bring God's kingdom into the world, if we wrestle within some godly rules. There's the big key. Godly rules. Last week, as we started this four-week sermon series on wrestling, I shared with you that I didn't know a whole lot about wrestling. It wasn't anything I did in high school. Well, this past week, not much has changed. I still don't know too much about wrestling. I did, however, go online and find that there are some rules when it comes to wrestling, high school wrestling, for instance. Let me share with you just a few of what I found online. There's probably more, but for instance, there's illegal holds or potentially dangerous holds that you can't do when you're wrestling, or the referee will penalize you. There are some technical violations. Here are some technical violations. Going off the mat or forcing your opponent off the mat, that's a technical violation. Grabbing clothing, grabbing the mat, grabbing your opponent's headgear, you can't do any of that. You can't lock or overlap your hands. You can't leave the mat without the referee's permission. And you can't report to the mat without being properly equipped. Additionally, here's just a few more. Rules against unnecessary roughness, unsportsmanlike conduct, flagrant misconduct, stalling, an incorrect starting position or false start. Some rules from wrestling. I'm sure there's a whole lot more. I don't know that much about it, but there's some rules. So I figured this. If there's rules for high school wrestling, do you think there's some godly rules for spiritual wrestling that maybe you and I can look into for those matches that we're going to have when we wrestle with each other? I believe there are. That's going to be the second part of the sermon. I want to look at some godly rules for wrestling. Before we go there, though, let's look at this one concept. Before we even get into wrestling, maybe the one thing we should consider if we're getting ready for a wrestling match, is this wrestling match even worth it? Is it even worth it? I got some scripture for you. Pretty familiar one. This is Paul, and he's dealing with some folks and an issue about food being clean or unclean. Let's just look at God's word here a little bit and see what Paul has to say about that before we get into the rules. Romans 14, 13 through 19 is where I'm at. Paul speaking. Therefore, let us stop passing judgment on one another. That's a good one to begin with. Instead, make up your mind not to put any stumbling block or obstacle in the way of a brother or sister. I am convinced, being fully persuaded in the Lord Jesus, that nothing is unclean in itself. But if anyone regards something as unclean, then for that person it is unclean. If your brother or sister is stressed because of what you eat, you are no longer acting in love. Do not by your eating destroy someone for whom Christ died. Therefore, do not let what you know is good be spoken of as evil. For the joy in the Holy Spirit, because anyone who serves Christ is pleasing to God and receives human approval. Therefore, let's make an effort to do whatever leads to peace and mutual edification. For Paul, I believe, as his words point out, wrestling over which foods were clean or not clean was just not worth it in the big picture. In the big picture of things, it just wasn't worth it. The kingdom of God, according to Paul's word, not a matter of eating or drinking, but a matter of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Food cleanliness for Paul was not worth wrestling over. Before we go into a wrestling match, we need to consider if it's worth it. Let's move on. There are, however, don't get me wrong, some things that are worth wrestling over. No doubt about that. And I think it's okay as long as we stay within those godly rules. Let's talk about some godly rules that I found here I want to kind of lift up. If we start to wrestle, here's rule number one that I found. We don't need to be talking bad about others while we're wrestling. Matthew 12, and this is 36 through 37. I tell you, on judgment day, people will give an account for every thoughtless word they have uttered. Because by your words you will be acquitted, and by your words you will be condemned. As we're wrestling with each other, folks, we need to control our tongues. We need to control our tongues. Our words can be most destructive. Most destructive. You ever experienced that? And sometimes we say something that we think is completely innocent, or maybe real close to being innocent, but the person receiving it takes it a different way completely. And it hurts them. cuts them to the very, very heart of things, and it takes years to be healed from such a thing. While we're wrestling, as we wrestle, we need to control our tongues. That's rule number one. With that in mind, let's move on to rule number two. If we're going to be wrestling with each other, knowing that our tongues can sometimes get out of whack, we need to use Scripture to back up our arguments. Use Scripture. Hebrews 4 and 12. For the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. God's Word is right there for us. We have God's Word available to us. Instead of opening our mouths and allowing our tongues to say things that we don't know what we're talking about, lean on God's Word. Lean on God's Word whenever we're wrestling. That's a safe way to go for sure. Number three. If we're going to be wrestling with each other, we need to keep in mind that you and I are not supposed to be judging others. It's not our job. That's Jesus' job, not ours. Do not judge others. Matthew 7, 1 through 3. Do not judge, or you will be judged. Anybody out there want to be judged today? Not me. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? We need to stay within the boundaries when we wrestle, and we're not supposed to be judging others. That's Jesus' job. It's way beyond our pay grade, shall we say. We do, however, have some responsibilities. As believers, we have some responsibilities when it comes to wrestling matches, some responsibilities that God indeed has given us, and one of them is holding each other accountable in Christian love. This is Galatians 6 and 1 through 2 is where we're at. Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in the spirit of gentleness. Don't forget that part. Keep watching yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. God's rules, God's word shows us that we have a responsibility for some Christian accountability. Christian accountability. And that can be an individual thing. It can also be a group thing. Matthew 18. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his faults between you and him alone. There's the individual. If he listens to you, you've gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, so that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. And then if he refuses to listen to them, tell the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let the church treat him as a Gentile or a tax collector. We have some responsibilities also when we wrestle, individual and as a group together, to live in Christian accountability. Even as we wrestle together, however, another thing I think we need to recognize that there might be times in the middle of our wrestling when the godly thing to do is to walk away. Walk away. That's the proper way to deal with some situations. We see this in the example of Paul and Barnabas, a pretty familiar scripture also. They were struggling over whether or not to bring Mark along on their next ministry efforts, and it just didn't work out. Acts 15, 37, 39, I'll share that with you. Barnabas wanted to take John, also called Mark, with them, but Paul did not think it was wise to take him because he had deserted them in Pamphylia and had not continued with them in the work. And here's the key. They had such a sharp disagreement that they parted company. There are times whenever we're wrestling with each other that it's appropriate that we just walk away from the situation. We reach an impasse and we can't do anything about it. We just need to walk away. Here's the final rule that I want to lift up. A rule that's appropriate for wrestling or many, many times in our lives. We need to be about forgiving each other. We need to be about forgiving each other. Matthew 6 and 14 and 15. Yes, if you forgive others for the wrongs they do to you, then your Heavenly Father will also forgive your wrongs. But if you don't forgive others, then your Heavenly Father will not forgive the wrongs you do. We need to be about forgiveness. No matter what we're wrestling or no matter the outcome, we need to shake hands and come off the mat as Christian friends. Here's the reality of our human condition. We're going to rub up against each other. In our journeys, in our spiritual journeys, we're going to walk, rub up against each other, and eventually it's inevitable that we're going to be wrestled. We're going to be wrestling with each other. Sometimes we wrestle over things that are very, very meaningful, very, very deep in what we believe, very foundational in what we believe. Sometimes we wrestle over those things. Sometimes, if we're honest, we wrestle over silly things, don't we? We really do. I've been in church meetings, been fighting over the carpet color for 3 years. It's silly stuff. Most of the time, I think we wrestle in the middle. In the middle. That's how and the things that we wrestle about are things in the middle. Not extreme in either way. I believe that it is completely appropriate that when we're in the middle of such a thing, we can and should wrestle to get to God's idea about the thing that we're wrestling over, as long as we wrestle within the rules, as long as we stay within the rules. This is what I think God has for us this morning, those two things. But one other thing that I want to share with you that I think God has for us also this morning is this. It's a much shorter subject, and we're not going to take nearly as much time, but I believe it's just as important, maybe even more important. When we're wrestling, we need to recognize that we are the ambassadors and God's hands and feet in this world. And guess what, folks? As we wrestle, people are watching. People are watching. As we wrestle, the world around us is watching. The broken world around us is watching. Anybody get the sense that the world is really looking for some answers now? In the middle of our situation, don't you think? I just feel like all society is just kind of reaching out. What's the answer? What's going on? The world is watching us. As we wrestle with each other, the world is watching how we wrestle. As we wrestle with each other, also, folks, here's the second thing. Our friends, our family, our children are watching. The future generation of Christians is watching how we wrestle. And here's the final one, maybe the most important one. As we wrestle, God is watching. God is watching how we wrestle. We indeed have a world in which we're going to be wrestling. I think it's okay if we wrestle within godly rules. I think God can do many, many good things in the middle of such a thing. As we're wrestling, God seems to be working on our hearts. On the hearts of us, on the hearts of the person that we're wrestling with, God is behind all of that, working to bring redemption in the middle of our wrestling matches. We can see that a little bit in the life of Jacob and Esau, can't we? They didn't like each other, as we talked about. Esau planned on killing Jacob. That's what he said. Jacob was a whole lot deceitful. They needed some heart work. They needed God to work on their hearts, and God did. In the middle of their wrestling and their lives, God was above, looking at them, working on their hearts, to the point that at one point they had some reconciliation. Genesis 33:4. But Esau ran to meet Jacob and embraced him. He threw his arms around his neck and kissed him, and they wept. God was indeed working on their hearts. Here's what I think God has for us this morning. We are indeed going to be wrestling in our relationship with others. It's just a matter of our human condition. I think it's okay if we wrestle, as long as we wrestle within the godly rules. And here's the last thing we need to remember, that people are watching as we wrestling. The world is watching. Our friends, our family, our children are watching. And God is watching. So go ahead and wrestle. Just keep in mind the big picture and what's going on. God's above it all. He can redeem the situation. Amen? Amen. We're going to invite the worship team to make their way back up. We're going to have a prayer as they do that. A reminder, if you want to leave an offering, there's an offering basket back there. one right here and one over there. So with those things in mind, as the worship team makes their way back up, let's be in an attitude of prayer. Let's talk to God. Holy God, we thank you for your word today. We thank you for our brothers and sisters as we walk this Christian journey. Be with us in case we have to wrestle. Please be with us. We need all the help that we can get with that. We know that you are above it and beyond it. So thank you. We bring to you today some tithes and some offerings. We ask you to bless them and multiply them. In Jesus' name, amen. Turn it over to the worship team.
All right, thank you, Pastor Bob. If you're able, please stand.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. And in darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life, you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. 'Cause your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And all my life, my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am made, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
I'm gonna sing, oh, I'm gonna sing. the right sticks now, buddy? Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Children of God, if you find yourself in a situation where you need to wrestle, wrestle within the godly rules. Make sure you understand that God is indeed watching, and God will redeem the situation. Go forth now. May the blessings of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you. In Jesus' name, amen.